So, dear ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry because of my spoken language, spoken English, I will read the lecture. I would like to present you the story of the Hungarian students of architecture who had been relocated to Denmark at the end of the World War II and returned to Hungary in 1946 and exerted the influences of Scandinavian neoclassical modernism to the post-World War Hungarian architecture. So, some words about the story of the evacuation. So, in the summer of the 1944, the Soviet Red Army crossed the historical borders of Hungary, and until October, they occupied the whole eastern part of the country. The Hungarian Eurocross government, that had a German-friendly administrative staff, began to flee towards Germany, taking along with them most of the national wealth, including factory production lines. The German military leadership still had the illusion that Germany would be able to make a peace agreement stopping the Allied forces on the borders of the fatherland. They had also set up an agreement with the Hungarian government according to which they would relocate graduate students to Germany. They would have come from professions considered to be essential for the rebuilding after the war. It had turned out only after the war that the agreement had never been ratified. The Soviet siege of Budapest started at the Christmas of 1944. The Hungarian military leadership could extricate the students from the closing blockade at the last moment. The third and fourth year students of engineering and architecture, medics, veterinary and pharmacology formed a group of 1,900 people. The students had a military call-up order. They risked capital punishment if resisted. Some could take their wives with them. Most of the professors refused to accompany them. The university leadership asked György Korompai, head of Department of Urban Planning, to go with the students as he was unmarried at the time. Four other architect instructors undertook the voyage. Leaving for Breslau, today's Wrocław, and later to Halle, their journey was eventful, as they were constantly running away from the front. Once they had to flee 150 kilometers by foot, cutting across fields of snow. They pulled their belongings on sledges made of their sketching boards. Several times they were tried to be recruited, and because of the incomplete teaching staff, their education were not be serious at all. Some engineering students lived through the terror bombing of Dresden. Seven of them had been killed. Finally, they also had to leave Halle when front approached. Engineering students had been guided to the south to Regensburg. Their train suffered a low-flying attack at Haslau. 36 of them had died. The group could not be kept together anymore, so they continued on their journey individually. The memory of the victims is preserved today by a plaque at the Technical University of Budapest. The students of architecture were sent to the north, to Denmark. The 77 students, some with wives, and six teachers spent the end of the World War II there in May. As displaced people, they were classified as friendly enemies and were taken care of by the Danish Red Cross. As real education was not possible there either, they gave classical music and theater performances, and several exhibitions were opened showing their works of art in Copenhagen and in Stockholm too. As time has passed, some students could get a job in Denmark or in Sweden, especially the watchful and talented ones in architect studios. They had gained professional experience and impressions of Scandinavian modern architecture through working and study tours. During the summer of 1946, the group had become disintegrated. Several people left off to Western Europe and overseas. About the half of them intended to return. Finally, they had arrived to Hungary in November of 1946 with the help of the Danish Red Cross. At home, their exams were passed along, their journey were not accepted. They graduated around the end of the 40s. They were received distrustfully because on one hand they were influenced by Scandinavian type of democracy, on the other hand they had escaped to Germany from the Soviets. They had to present themselves before a screening committee. Some of the accompanying teachers were defamed. Thus ended the odyssey of the displaced students of architecture at the end of the World War II. Okay, some words about the post-war Hungarian architecture. I'm in a very good situation because Anna Maria gave us a very good summary of that era. So, the scarce resources of Hungary, that has a very poor economic situation after the war, had to be spent on the reconstruction of buildings damaged through the battles. Although 3/4 of the buildings of Budapest were injured through the siege of the city and the previous bombings, only 4% of the buildings were completely destroyed. Most of them could be rebuilt. The few new buildings carried on the traditions of Hungarian modern architecture between the two world wars, mainly based on the Bauhaus and Italian modern architecture. In 1948, construction companies employed more than 100 people were nationalized. At the same time, architects' jobs were nationalized too. During some years, almost every Hungarian architect and engineer had been pushed to state or governmental planning firms. Some significant architects of the ancient regime had been studio leaders. Others could hold on the end of the hierarchy. In 1951, the great architectural debate was taking place in Hungary. The Communist Party had pressed on the style of socialist realism derived from Stalin and Zhdanov to Hungarian architects. This was achieved by the leadership of the main ideologist of the party and an architect who had came home from Moscow, Imre Perényi. Definition of the socialist realism gave national appearance to socialist content. But ideologists of the Hungarian architecture quarreled a lot about which era of the Hungarian historical architecture could represent best national values compatibly the socialist content. Finally, they had canonized the architecture of Hungarian classicism, pressing the application of tympanums, meanders, and Doric colossal orders to modern architects. After the famous industrial building speech of Khrushchev in 1954, gradual transition had started in Hungary too. In the next few years, the last social realist buildings had been built, but rumor has it that there was an architect who had modified his plans to modern ones according to Khrushchev's speech, but before the official change of direction. During the Hungarian Revolution in 1956, many buildings of Budapest were badly damaged by the Soviet army. The first phase of rebuilding had been one of the first relevant projects of Hungarian late modern architecture. A few dozen modern urban dwelling houses were built in the city. In the following decade, Hungarian architects based on the classic modern roots of Bauhaus, but between the realities of socialist planned economy, had planned and built numerous high-quality houses and complexes until the basic changes in the national economy in 1968. Okay, some words about the Danish group of the Hungarian architectures. Although architects returned from Denmark did not form the coherent, homogeneous group, still one of the recurring myths of the historiography of Hungarian architecture is that Scandinavian architecture has taken a notable effect on Hungarian architecture through the work of the Danish architects. According to historians, there are two essential traces of this influence. One was using the materials known from Scandinavia, for example, brick and wood. The other was importing the idiom of Scandinavian neoclassic modern architecture when Hungarian architects were expected to use archaism during the socialist realist era. Some of the returned 40 students had become famous architects in Hungary as designers, building engineers, and renovators of monument buildings. Three of them is often mentioned as the transmitters of the Scandinavian influence. Let's have a look at their houses. At first, Zoltán Farkasdi. Zoltán Farkasdi is one of the architects who later made a bright career in Hungary. He had worked in architect studios even in Denmark. At first, he was employed in the Benedicts and Klein architect's office. Later, he had become a colleague of Jørn Utzon. The Danish architect is known worldwide as the designer of the Sydney Opera House. Farkasdi returned to Hungary in 1947, later than the others, graduated, and be admitted to the Office for Planning Public Buildings, known as Kösti, where he had become the colleague of István Janáki Senior, the famous Hungarian architect of the 30s. Here they planned the buildings of the University of Heavy Industry in Miskolc, together with two other Danish-Hungarian architects, György Jánosi and Lajos Zalavári. His first realized own plan, still signed together with Janáki, was the ST building of the Technical University of Budapest. The brick facing is often mentioned in connection with this house as the Scandinavian stylistic mark, although almost all the buildings of the Technical University had been built with brick facade during the previous decades. What is for sure, Scandinavian architecture is not foreign for it. Farkasdi's early own signed buildings were born during the socialist realist era. His standard design for village community centers, which had been built in five settlements, and the main building of the College of Applied Arts in Budapest are clearly connected to Hungarian classicism, but the fierce raster of the windows and the gentle asymmetry of the composition displays the experience in Scandinavian modern architecture. His buildings to vacant lots of the Buda Castle district and to the urban neighborhood of Óbuda show us a designer who was more sensitive to the built environment than many of the doctrinarian architects of his time. In the castle, he was cooperated with another Danish architect, Tamás Dragonics. Until his early death, he had planned two large, significant buildings of the Hungarian 60s and 70s. The Hospital of Dunaújváros is one of the most referred houses of its time. Hotel Olympia, which was built to accommodate Hungarian sportsmen during their training camp in the Buda Hills, had an extreme large planning program and a very inflexible structural system based on tunnel formwork. In spite of these circumstances, Farkasdi had planned a building which tried to adapt itself to its environment with wooden facades and with its large body divided to smaller cubes. Another Danish Hungarian architect, György Jánosi. György Jánosi had also gained experience in architecture during his stay in Scandinavia before becoming a famous Hungarian architect of the post-war period. Several exhibitions were organized in Denmark and Sweden showing his paintings. After he was invited to study trip to Sweden by the Svenska Institute. He started to work as an assistant of Hungarian-born architect Georg Várhelyi in Stockholm. Later, he returned to Copenhagen, where he started to work with the famous Danish architect Ole Falkentorp. After returning to Hungary and graduating, he also started to work in István Janáki's studio in Kösti. The first building they designed together was a community center that had been realized in Hódmezővásárhely. The scientific literature often emphasizes the connection between the house and Danish architecture, although it is hard to value what part of the design were added by the two architects. Jánosi also participated in designing of the University of Heavy Industry in Miskolc. The student hostels were signed by Jánosi and Janáki together. These had been built during the socialist realist era, but their neoclassical modern shaping is nearer to the Scandinavian modernism than the Hungarian classicism. The water tower of Gödöllő is maybe the most significant point of Jánosi's career and in the history of Hungarian architecture, where the influence of the Scandinavian architecture can be observed. As Jánosi was supported to use archaic forms, he had reached back to his experiences about Scandinavian modernism. This work is one of the 8 examples which have local protection of Budapest from the post-war era. Shall go to Arjan again. Jánosi was actively involved in the planning of Hungary's most homogeneous modernist town. He got the job to design a hotel to Salgótarján together with György Szrók, who planned the new community center. He criticized the socialist realist master plan of the new city center, mainly because of their intervention. The master plan had been modified to a doctrinarian modern one. Between the new circumstances, Jánosi could plan Hotel Karancs as a modern building without any compromises. While in Salgótarján, the new city center had erased the old urban structure, in the Budakeszthely district, Jánosi planned a dwelling house between the historical buildings, which could adapt itself to its surroundings. His house, with brick facades painted white, gave to ovation by the critics of its time. One decade later, he used this kind of facade again on his house for diplomats, but the monotonous building, which showed the form of the large public buildings of its time, had not been really successful. Jánosi's dwelling house in Óbuda, with its facades made of brick and wood, and with its concrete tectonic elements, is another important building in Hungary, which is told as being an example for the Danish effects for Hungarian architecture. And at last, Lajos Zalavári. Lajos Zalavári had also worked in Georg Várhelyi's studio in Stockholm. After returning to Hungary and graduating, he went to work to István Janáki's studio, to Kösti as well, just as Jánosi and Farkasdi. From 1960, he had led the studio after Janáki's retirement. The using of brick accompanied him through his career, and from the 70s, he has become one of the leaders of Hungarian postmodern ambitions. He kindly emphasizes the Scandinavian roots of his architecture. His block of flats in Óbuda was born in the middle of the socialist realist era. With its modernist forming and gently neoclassical details, it was clearly the result of Zalavári's Scandinavian experience. The primary school in the village of Feldebrő is a modern building in spite of the archaism of the era. The classrooms have double-sided daylighting. With its ashlaring, the school is rather linked to the vernacular modernism. His housing estate, signed together with Pál Oltai in Csepel, one of the industrial centers in Budapest, was free of archaism even during the 50s, and it foreshadowed the late modern architecture of the 60s in Hungary. In spite of many modernist housing estates, the placing of the houses is playfully rhythmical, the buildings are colored vividly. One of his well-known works is the Purity Bath in Jászberény, which is now functioning as a thermal spa. With its statue-like details, it is unique. It is a unique example of Hungarian architecture of the 60s. Neither Zalavári had the choice to follow this direction later. On his public buildings planned during the 60s, brick facades appear again, referring back to his Scandinavian experience. One significant example is the Institute of the Deaf in Budapest. Another is the student hostel and canteen built for the Technical University of Budapest, which is closely related to Farkasdi's ST building. And a short summary. The previously showed buildings are only examples taken by random from the career of these three architects. I showed houses by homes, same Scandinavian influence can be presumed. What is for certain, the well-known Danish-Hungarian architects were participants of the Master School of the Association of the Hungarian Architects at its beginning, and they formed a group that had a tremendous effect on Kösti and the Hungarian architecture of the 50s and the 60s and 70s. Their colleagues, pupils and friends were affected by their stories about Scandinavian architecture and feeling, and they passed from the hand-to-hand albums of Gunnar Asplund and Sigurd Leverenc that had been brought home by the Danish-Hungarian architects. It was supplemented by their activities as university teachers, therefore it could be said that they exerted a significant influence on the post-war Hungarian architecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Abel. Now we have time for questions.
Thank you very much for this lecture, very interesting. So you mentioned this, 48, where the state-owned architecture office were founded. So I'm curious how it works, because you have always this names, Kösti, Ipar, Terf, Lakoterf, and all these offices, but you still have the names of the architects. So were some kind of ateliers within this state-owned office, or how it worked?
Oh, it's a difficult question. I suppose there were, at the very beginning, there were only a few state or governmental planning firms, about five or six, and later they were devoted to many and many new planning firms, and some of the famous architects of during the two world wars had a studio, an own studio in these architecture firms, so they could make a kind of school around them, I suppose. No, of course not. It's very interesting that at the beginning these firms were specialized. So there was one especially for public buildings, there was another one for dwelling houses, another one Ipartervis for industrial buildings. And of course they had the work, they had the job, so they were told, okay, as Jánosi, that okay, let's plan a hotel to Salgó Tarján. And usually in the planning institutes, inside the planning institutes, juries were working, which could push the architects to okay, it's not will be good, not would be good, I suppose.
Thank you for the interesting lecture. From the very beginning, when I saw this title of yours, I was interested because of this very important Scandinavian element in different national architectures. It's very early, really, and my question will be connected to how they were accepted when they returned in 48 and 50, how they could use their Scandinavian influences. Because if I could compare Scandinavian impact for architecture in post-war Estonia and Lithuania, it was actually the thing that helped them to jump into the leaders, because it's of course later in they started to go in this organized study trips in 59, so, and I think until 64 almost all modern architects from Estonia and Lithuania visited Finland especially, and I see extremely striking parallels. They use the same elements like red brick facades, wood in the exterior, and they believed it so deeply and they perceived it so deeply that in the 1980s there was the questionnaire of architects, how would they define the Lithuanian architecture? They write down all the Scandinavian elements, so it's very interesting. It's more like comment, but the question is about this early time when they returned.
There were two ways. The classic modern architects in Hungary knew the Scandinavian architecture between the two world wars, as knew Bauhaus and Italian modern or Russian cubism. They knew and they used it. But after the war, you know, the Iron Curtain fell down, and almost all the Hungarian architects were closed inside it. And that was the very interesting thing, that these 40 people, 40 architects, has the experience in the Scandinavian architecture, and it is legendary that they had some albums of Asplund and Leverenz, and they showed it to the others. So, I suppose during the socialist realism era, realist era, it was the most interesting, because they can use this idiom to do the expected archaism on the way that he could stay modern architects as well.
Just an answer of this name question. I think, as far as I know, in the early 50s, the state treated the architects like artists, and that's because they could use their name, because they were, I saw the plans were like artificial things, so that's the deal between the state and arts, and that's why you can always find the names on the plans and later too. My question is, you said that the Scandinavian influences or using Scandinavian models was an answer, a reaction of the socialist realist impact. So what happened later? Because after the socialist period, you can always, how you can explain that there's always the using after this period is.
Yes, so it is often said by the historians that there was a Scandinavian effect in the Hungarian architecture in the 60s and in the 70s, with using of brick facades and wooden facades. For example, this house is often mentioned as a Scandinavian affected house, but I suppose that these architects had been old and went. They finished their job, and maybe their students know their experiments from Scandinavia, but of course this flowed down the story.
I have a very specific question. How I don't know if you know the answer, but how could they get into Kösti, since you said they were unsafe? And most of their contemporaries were punished for that.
They were invited because on the Technical University of Budapest, the leading teachers were the same as the leading architects in Kösti, in Ipartek, and the other famous architecture firms. So if they saw a talented young architect, they invited them to Kösti or any part of or the other one.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Could you say something to what they have learned or what has been taught in Budapest during wartime? So what did they learn before? I guess it wasn't modernism. So, yeah.
I just made an interview with one of the Danish-Hungarian architects, and I have asked this. And I suppose during the war and between the two world war, Hungarian architects were showed almost all the European modern architecture, especially, of course, the Bauhaus. It was, the most important. But very important was as well the Italian modern architecture, as some architects and artists could go out to Rome with with a kind of Roman scholarship. It was called Roman scholarship. So they could learn and study in Italy. But this old architect, Tamás Dragonics, said to me that they know Scandinavian architecture, they know Russian Cubism, they know maybe the modern architecture of Netherlands. So before the war, they was